fucking demolished. Terribly sorry about that, guys. XSplit thought it would be cute to crash out of nowhere in the middle of pre-show, and I had to restart my computer, so we are getting back into the podcast now. I need to get back to Discord immediately. This is no bueno. I have been in many situations like this in my history. God damn. Please tell me the crew has not abandoned me.
Huge space.
The crew has not abandoned me, thank God. Holy shit.
I'm here, babe.
Who started the whole crew thing?
I did.
Was it you?
Yes. Twas I. Okay. Got a problem with it, mate? So unfortunately, I was gonna put a nice little Dark Souls 3 all bosses speedrun up on stream, but now I gotta get that sorted. So just give me a few moments, people. Anyway, hello everybody. Welcome to the Bonfire Lit Comfy Cast. This is episode 20. Holy shit, it's not been 20 weeks because we've just recently gone on a fucking schedule, and even then we don't really follow it that closely.
No.
But as always, my name is Vash TSP, and who's with me today?
Hello, I am John Williams, otherwise known as Turbo Button, or as the ladies call me, hey, you with the binoculars. I'm actually here time this week. How about that?
Yes, yes, John joins us before the show, even. And who else is here?
My name is Dax, otherwise known as my Dax.
Oh.
Sorry, I dropped my
controller! Oh, your controller, video game mm-hmm. podcast.
Yeah.
No
yeah.
way.
Yeah. Well, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to spoil it.
All right. So, starting the show off as we like to every week with a bit of a recap of what we've been up to. Everybody who's on this week was on last week, correct?
I was not on last week.
Oh, okay.
I was around. I was just busy.
Okay. So, Dax, how about you start us off? What have you been up to recently, man?
I've been working on quite a number of things, mostly some events in the speedrun community, uh-huh. which I'm actually helping out with, like, as I'm kind of doing this. The very massive and hard to communicate with everyone, because everyone's from all over the world, the Sonic community is uh-huh. putting on a month-long sort of racing event where every single day we have two individual races going on for a specific game, and today is, like, Sonic Heroes. Yesterday was Sonic 1 on the Game Gear. Previous day of Sonic Generations where we started. And so we have a few restreamers. I'm doing restreams throughout. And we basically just kind of grab a couple streams that are going on currently and put them up on the layout and then have people in the chat or whatever on the main Sonic Speed Marathon channel right. that we use for, like, our big events that we do, like the Sonic Speed Marathon. So this is more of, like, a racing specific thing. And I can't really say this has been done before as far as, like, a big race thing with a bunch of different games that goes on the entire month.
Right.
And it's pretty hefty. So I've been trying, originally I started out as just doing, like, layouts and shit and not kind of, like, working half of it. But it's fun though. I like being able to help out the community and they seem to be pretty appreciative of it. So it's just been a lot of work, but I've been doing that, trying to just monitor everything and participating in what I can. And like this Sunday, I'll be restreaming Sonic 06 and participating in that. So that'll be fun.
Gotcha. Will
and,
you be running? Yeah. So just, you?
Yeah, I'll be running in it. Oh, again, we do two races during the day. We do one at around 2 p.m. Eastern, and then for European time,
uh-huh.
and so earlier in the day for us, so that way they can play, and then like 6 hours later, so around like 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, we do another race. So that way, the American boys, when they get home from school and all that shit, they can play, and then we take all those scores and then add them up, or not add them up, but we put them together so where as if it was one race, and then we have this whole, like, kind of golf-ish point system that we're going to be doing. So okay. it kind of rewards, like. It's more of a get together kind of fun thing for the community, but we're also doing some sort of scoring system, maybe a prize thing at the end where the more you participate, the better you can do, instead of it just being like, oh, if I dominate this one game, I'm super high up.
Uh-huh.
Like Frokonok, who destroyed everyone in Generations the first day, he didn't participate the next day in Sonic 1 8-bit. So instead of being, you know, first place, he's like sixth now because, you know, it rewards. The more games you play with it, it's rewarding of that.
Gotcha.
But it's fun. It's been really cool. So we're doing that. And of course I have, right after that's over, July 2nd through the 10th, I have SGDQ, which I'll be, commentating for Sonic 06 and that and some other stuff. So there's, like, a bunch of fucking speedrun shit
Yeah.
That I've been working on and participating in. And just playing a bunch of different games. All these, like, I'm trying to participate as much as I can in this month, and all these different games. Like, I tried doing Sonic 1 on Game Gear yesterday. I couldn't beat it. It doesn't have continues, and you just get fucked. So, like, everyone else had played at least a little bit, and I didn't play at all. And I was like, it'll be fine. No, it's so fucking brutal. That game sucks ass.
Okay.
It just sucks dick. So, been doing that, but just a bunch of Sonic games, mostly, like, 06 and Unleashed and all that kind of stuff. I think you've been probably seeing me stream lately. Yeah. And yeah, a bunch of that stuff as well as other little video things that I've been getting to. And yeah.
And regarding the Sonic Marathon, is there a place where people can go to see who is restreaming what and when?
Yeah, there actually is a doc.
There's a document.
I believe so.
Documentary.
Yes. Let me go. Well, here, I'll go ahead and I'll link the stream for right now.
Yeah.
I'll just throw it in there. So if anyone's interested, again, it's there is a set schedule. It's always 2 p.m. Eastern, or I'm sorry, 2 p.m. European time, and then 8 p.m. Eastern time is when we do the races, and we'll be doing that throughout the month. And then there's like a Twitter below it. You can find all that shit. And then the, yeah. So that's going on with that.
Okay. Is that all you've been up to?
Pretty much, yeah. Just mostly getting all that done. Should be pretty okay now. I don't have to, like, fucking mommy everyone and just making sure, like, you got your layouts done, you got your food, and don't forget to have some water. You know, fucking having to monitor everything. I can actually go away from the stream. Yeah, I can actually walk away from the stream and make sure that they know what they're doing.
Gotcha.
Okay. Yeah, should be pretty good for the rest of the month.
All right. John.
All right.
Oh, Pokey.
Oh, wait, hold on.
All right, we're safe. So, John.
Yeah, I escaped the cage.
What are you up to right now, John? We'll get to Pokey in a second.
Well, I've been studying for exams. I've got a shitload next week. But other than that, I've been playing some video games. I replayed Super Metroid, and I've been replaying Metroid Prime. Two of, in my opinion, the greatest games ever made.
Uh-huh.
They are fucking masterpieces, both of them, and they're fucking awesome. What else have I been playing? I was playing something on on Steam a while ago, but I can't exactly remember. But okay. Mostly those two.
Okay.
I've sort of gained a new appreciation for Super because my friend's watching the stream and he just keeps sending me messages being a dickhead. Saying
chat? Can
Super
I
Metroid
them?
Is not as good as B movie.
Wow, you have of those types.
Yeah. Anyway, so I was playing some Metal Gear Rising, on the PC version.
Oh, so you finally got a real PC video game.
No. I already had Metal Gear Rising just on my broadcast PS3. For some reason, I downloaded the Jetstream Sam and Blade Wolf DLC, but it never actually showed up on my menu for some reason. So I've finally played the Jetstream Sam one, although I haven't beat it, because fuck Armstrong in the Jetstream Sam DLC. That Sonic attack he does can just, like...
God, John, just... you're so bad at video games.
Shut up.
What difficulty? What difficulty are you playing on?
Oh, I'm playing on the hardest difficulty.
Very hard or Vengeance?
Oh, I don't know. I don't think it's Revengeance.
Okay.
Mostly Super Metroid and Metroid Prime. And like I can barely talk about these games without gushing. And I mean before I liked Super Metroid, but Prime was like definitively my favorite. Replaying Super Metroid, because the last time I played it was a couple years ago now. Replaying it has given me such an appreciation for this game. Because it's just so well made. The only low point is Meridia, especially considering if you don't have the space jump, you can get locked in one part and then you have to go all the way out, all the way back around again, which sucks. But the rest of the game is just fantastic. Fucking brilliant game, and everyone should play it, including you, Vash, you son of a bitch. You still haven't played a single Metroid game. That's all for me.
Yeah. Okay. Pokey this.
Yeah, I escaped the cage.
The cage? So you're back?
The one that you held me in. Fuck you. I escaped.
Oh, well, you know, it's all right. Some things happened, and maybe I threw away a key or two. It's all right. I'll get you back in eventually.
Yeah, I can make... I have thick enough pubes. I can do it myself.
just cut to Pokey, like, trying to turn his pubes into a lockpick for the key.
Wait, no!
And he just constantly...
Wait, no.
He always has this, just the look of pure pain. And
my mate's tricked someone into smashing pubes once.
What is wrong? Is this the one in chat?
What?
Oh god, this is the degree of delinquency.
Yeah.
I thought the story I told Dax about was pretty bad, but
we're fucking disgusting.
No, it was that, and in the same night, there was also a tampon.
Oh my god.
Oh my god.
Yeah.
To be young again.
Anyway, carry on. I just thought that was worth it.
So, you know, I wasn't cruel while I had you locked in the cage. I did give you a PlayStation 4 with which to play so many wonderful games.
Yeah. I finally got to see X-Men Days of Future Past, Mad Max, Jurassic World.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, it wasn't too bad.
Okay.
So I've tried out three different games this week.
Ooh. Okay, hit me with them.
Of the three, I only kept one. The other two I returned because, well, fuck you, Steam. There's no demo there. But thank you for the return program. So if I dislike the game, I do return it, get my refund, and I did on two of those games. So the first game I played was Senran Kagura, which I had actually been looking forward to for quite some time because I always hear the talk of how Senran Kagura is pretty fucking great. And then I play the game, and...
Not a fan?
I'm not a fan. Like, I'm not going to tell people who like it they're wrong, because I could see probably why they do. It definitely has that certain appeal for, like the Idolmasters crowd, you know?
Right.
It's got a bunch of high-pitched, squeaky lollies with these giant tits. Mm. They're,
I'm a fan.
They're, like, here's the thing. I'm a tits dude, too. I love tits.
Uh-huh.
But the way that
they're... So do I. So do we all.
The way that they're animated and the way that they're drawn are so unappealing because they look like balloons. They don't look like boobs. They just look like these very cartoonish boobs that have that.
Sorry,
just
wait,
have
hold on. I blanked out for a sec. Are we actually talking about a video game? Like what?
Yes.
Yes, John. Yes.
Part of the Senran Kagura draw is it's sex appeal, and that's fine. Because like there's this whole thing where it's like, wow, the more damage you do to the enemy boss, they lose clothes, and the more damage done to you, you lose clothes.
Is that like a reverse Bayonetta?
Yeah, kind of. I don't know. Actually, maybe I can't recall because I played two different games like that this week.
Uh-huh.
I know for certain that one of them, and I know which one it is, when the more clothes you lose during battle, the higher your crit and damage rate goes up.
Uh-huh.
For Senran Kagura, I'm not sure if that was one of the bonuses.
Oh, okay. For whatever reason, I fucking, on my autismo changed that to Sengoku Basara. I apologize. Okay. Yeah, I know what you're talking about now. All right, it makes sense.
Oh, if I was playing, if Sengoku Basara was on PC, that'd be sick.
Oh, that'd be dope.
I was surprised. I was like, what the fuck?
Yeah, no. This is Senran Kagura. It's really I don't find it to be a very fun Musou.
Okay.
I'll immediately admit that I'm not even like a huge Musou fan, but
you didn't have fun with it.
If the gameplay is just fun enough as it is, I can definitely get into it and stick with it till the end. But for this one, it's very slow and boaty.
Yeah.
I was not a huge fan of the combat in general. I played some girls from the Gesen school and from the Hajime school. And none of them I found to be fun. A lot of their combos were painfully boring in the very beginning. And I didn't stick with it long enough to really dig into like the depth of their combos or, you know, equipment management and stuff like that. Cause you know, there's like dressing up the girls. I don't know if the dressing up affects their damage output or anything.
Right.
It probably does. I'm going to give the game the benefit of the doubt, but honestly, it just did not it put me to sleep right away. Like, if a game's just going to put me to sleep right away, then I don't care. And by the way, I put it on my solid state drive, and the load times were still pretty bad.
Okay.
Really?
I found that was really odd.
There's an important debate going around the chat. Arse or tits?
Ass.
Ass.
No middle ground. Okay. No middle ground. This is not a yes, no, pass question mark. This is a tits or ass question.
Yeah, you can't say, well, everyone likes both, but you're always a man of one or the other.
Exactly. No. Everyone likes both, but it always depends on who's wearing it. If I were to, like, gun to my head.
Wearing what?
You put a gun to my head.
Wait a minute, is this lore?
I'm probably going to go, oh, Jesus, that's so difficult. God, that's so hard.
This is like, these are the important questions of a video game podcast.
You can stick your pee-pee in just about anything, which is like the best thing about being a dude. Fuck.
Yeah, dude, I love going to Subway.
Oh, yeah, dude. Fucking hot surf food, man.
Always toasted.
I'm gonna go, like, I love me hips and legs, and I do love the booty, but you know what?
Mm-hmm. Wow.
I think the one thing that gets me drooling the fastest is a nice pair of tits. It's probably what gets me drooling the fastest.
Pokey gets me. Pokey feels me. It feels like we're even on this podcast now.
Dax, yeah. You have the ass life, right?
Of course.
All right, yeah. All right, sick. We'll call it broke. We'll call it even. Fuck it. So anyway.
Anyway,
so
what's the other Samurai Musou Kagura? Just so we can get right to the comparisons, what's the other Musou you've been playing?
The other one I was playing was Hyper Dimension Neptunia U.
Oh, okay, all right, yeah. Oh. That's also on PC, right?
Yes, that came out a couple months ago. I didn't hear about it until a couple days ago because I don't really follow the whole Nep crowd because I find the just general designs and storytelling to be god awful,
pretty,
terribly
it's pretty
annoying,
fucking dumb.
Yeah, it's and like I get that it's tongue in cheek. I understand that. I know no one's actually like going into the Nep games and loving the story because they're taking it seriously. I understand a lot of people are taking it like they're taking it for that tongue in cheek. I get that, but it still doesn't really appeal to me.
Mm-hmm.
So that being said, the gameplay in Hyper Dimension Neptunia U definitely, in my opinion, definitely better than in Senran Kagura because it's faster.
Mm. Oh, really?
The character variety just felt better in general, except for Ram and Ram. They felt kind of shitty. Mm. But Nep Gear and the other Nep one, I can't remember her name, they both felt like, obviously, they're sort of like the vanilla characters, so they do feel very solid for vanilla characters.
Okay.
But still, in general, like, I mean, part of the problem with Senran Kagura is that it had very unsatisfying animations.
Yeah.
And also, like I said, the bodies were very unsatisfying just in general as well.
Are you sure?
In Hyper Dimension of Tunia, I feel the same way a lot. Like, it has better animations than Senran Kagura, yes.
Uh-huh.
But they're still not of the tier where it's like, hey, that's pretty good. You know, it's still just kind of lackluster.
That's pretty blue.
Mm-hmm. Hold on. Wait, is this just like a Musou spinoff? Because for some reason I felt like...
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I was about to say, I thought these games were like turn-based RPGs.
They start out that way. Fun fact, actually, not. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to cut in Pokey. I was just going to mention that. Because as a joke, a friend of mine who wanted to speedrun Neptunia U when it came out on Vita was like talking to me, an old friend of mine, and he was like, yeah, dude, you could join in and fucking run it.
Wait, so can I just interrupt?
Yeah.
So please.
I made a joke about Pokey being like the creator of Berserk.
Oh.
And then he goes and plays fucking idle games, so he's always like proving my fucking point, and this is great.
is it helping to push the narrative that you want?
Well, like, you're proving my point and it's making me happy. Also, I want to add that Pokey can never give a yes or no answer to anything.
I know.
No, because there's choices are tough, dude. You have to dwell on these things for a while.
Barbecue chicken or buffalo chicken? Assuming.
Oh, oh my god! Definitely oh, buffalo. That's a definitely question.
I'm definitely gonna go for buffalo.
I love.
Okay, see.
Oh, god.
It's possible it just doesn't have an oven.
I legit don't know. I love barbecue food. Hey, barbecue sauce or ketchup?
Fucking barbecue sauce, easily.
Yes, there we go. I've met so many utter pagans who think ketchup, and it's disgusting. Oh no, ketchup isn't disgusting, but I mean it's disgusting that they say ketchup.
Well, ketchup is in a lot of barbecue sauces, so that's not really fair.
Yeah, but that's how you elevate it. You make it better. You turn it from shit to something good.
That's true.
Like when Dark Souls became Bloodborne.
Ah!
Jesus.
Right. So, Pokey, wrapping it up about the Musos.
Right. Right. So, yeah. Hyperdimension of TNEAU. Just in general, another Musou that I just found to be rather lackluster. At the end of the day, I wasn't really having fun. In fact, actually, one of the downsides to Hyperdimension of TNEAU compared to Senran Kagura is that with Senran Kagura, I could at least see enemies wind up for attacks to do things to me.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
it made it easier to dodge. In Hyperdimension, I guess they expect you to go in there with a knowledge of what an enemy looks like when they're going to attack from playing the previous games. Because I was losing health not knowing when something hit me.
Mm-hmm. Vash enemy telegraphing.
You're bad at Transformers Devastation, John. We'll get there. We'll get there. You're terrible.
So there was one more game that I played.
Even on the Google Doc.
Yeah, what else is up? What else is up, Pokey?
Google Doc.
Wait, is this the one that you actually liked?
Yes. Ooh. So I played a game this week. By the way, I did play some more Transformers Devastation. I'm still loving it, by the way.
Best game.
Yeah, but I mean, I already spoke about enough of that last week.
I'm more of a TMNT.
The other game that I played that I found out that I like, and I cannot understand the hate for. I can understand why it probably gets a bad rap, maybe, but Onichimbara Z2 Chaos came out on PC recently.
Oh,
just yesterday.
What a verbal salad of a title.
Yes. So Onichimbara.
Onichimbara.
It is a. Budget title. It is a budget title that feels like less of a budget title than the other two games I played this week.
Okay.
The animations are really fucking good. It has like combat. Like it actually feels good to hit things and slash them, and it has combos. Like the combos extend beyond just the simple starter kits that they gave you in Senran Kagura and Hyperdimension Neptunia U, which, by the way, both of those games, I'm giving the benefit of the doubt that you get more combos along the way. I'm not saying that you don't. You probably do.
You don't.
Oh, okay, never mind.
No, I speedrun Neptunia U for a couple months. You don't get anything like that.
Wow, that's
you can bad. Go. You get slightly different modifiers when you're in your fucking transform mode or whatever, HDD but like form, it's really not that different. It's very basic.
You should have expected this. No one plays Hyperbit Neptunia for the actual gameplay.
Neptunia was that all the assets, animations, everything, and I was going to mention, like, when you talked about how there's no, like, startup to everything, even the levels themselves are dungeons that are brought from the other games. Like, it's all assets.
Yeah,
every single bit is an asset that's brought from the other games. So that's why they didn't change the animations. You hear, like, a little sound or whatever, but yeah, there's no indicator. Like, it looks like, I think they just took the assets and made it in, like, a week.
Yeah. Yeah, it does feel like that, you know, that was probably thrown together rather fast. I mean, even though, like, the straight-up level design is, like, it's less involved than Phantasy Star Online.
And yeah, it's literally the dungeons from the RPG.
Yeah.
I actually went and compared it. It is the exact same rooms and everything, but they didn't change anything.
That makes me all the less enticed to ever play.
Yeah, it's exactly the same.
All the
models, all the enemies are just like a few of the enemies from the other one. All the levels are just directly pulled. Like if you watch some gameplay from a basic dungeon of like one of the other games, especially the first one, yeah, you can see it's like, oh, that's the same fucking map. Just like a portion of it.
Right.
That's a bit of a letdown because I was very unimpressed with the level design in general in that game. And of course, obviously, like I said, the enemy animations.
Yeah, because it's from a fucking RPG dungeon. That's why.
Yeah. the cool thing about Onichimbara Z2 Chaos. Jesus Christ, that title.
Revengeance.
I'll just call it Chaos. Let's call it Z2.
Back to the revenge.
So in Z2, they have weapon switching mid combo. And character switching mid combo.
What type
and
you can
do
game
both of those things mid combo. Onichimbara Z2 Chaos. It's on Steam.
What type of game? Is it a beat 'em up or is it a musou?
It's a beat 'em up. It's definitely it's a stylish beat 'em up. You know, it does not have the same fluidity and like finesse that you would find in a Bayonetta or a Devil May Cry. You're not gonna find that here. But despite it being rough, and despite it being a budget title, there's some genuine depth to it and a lot of really satisfying combat. Like, you fight repetitive hordes of very samey-looking zombies all the time. And by the way, you have a gap closer. Okay, I gotta explain the gap closer. Oh, so, man. How you do it is you hold down the jump button. which means that if you want to do a normal jump, you have to tap it. And accidentally doing the gap closer, which is called a chase, doing the chase is easier than actually jumping because, you know, you might just be used to like hammering on the jump button to jump to places in most other games. You do that in Onii-chan Barra, and then you do the chased attack. Now, the thing is, like, I've yet to encounter, I'm like four chapters in, I've yet to encounter any spot where I've had to jump anywhere specifically. That's never been a thing that I had to do. I don't know if it's going to end up being a problem later on. I got used to learning how to jump neutrally in the game, but the fact that I had to learn how to neutral jump in the game, or just to lightly tap even while moving, is kind of weird. But the cool thing about the chase attack, though, is that when you, like, even if you hover over enemies while you're doing the chase gap closer, it drags them up in the air with you. So then you can start doing air combos. And then, like I said, midair, you know, you could swap characters and you could swap weapons and, you know, you could do all this shit. It's really satisfying. You just sort of cut everything in half and beat it the fuck up and split it and do all sorts of super gory moves. And it's really good. I mean, honestly, my few complaints are that I heard Zach was in the Discord last night. He said that Z1 had directional inputs. I haven't found any thus far in Z2 yet. Maybe they are, or maybe I'm fucking up super hard on how to execute them. But here's a fun fact. It has rebindable keys, rebindable buttons. I was able to do a button layout similar to Bayonetta 2 and just have fun and play the game like how I play Bayonetta.
Okay.
I was really happy about that.
Okay. Is that all you've been up to?
In terms of games, yeah, pretty much.
Sam, are you actually on the cast? You just come on a shitpost.
Yeah, I'm here. Fuck it.
What have you been up to?
I've drank like two Desperados, so I mean, whatever.
Yeah?
Yeah. Yeah. For those who don't know, Desperados is tequila beer.
Hit me with the good
boy
shit.
Drinks.
What have you been doing? What have you been up to?
Alright, so this week I'm on Overwatch. I got my 3DS back.
Uh-huh.
So I've been delving back into that, playing all my beautiful games like my Monster Hunter, my Shin Megami Tensei, and Pokemon Blue Version.
Good.
Yeah.
So yeah, you've been having
some fun. Oh yeah, that's what I was playing. I played some Fire Red, I was doing a Nuzlocke. Carry on, sorry.
I came to the realization, I was like, oh yeah, the first generation was fucking awful.
Yeah. It's like, hard to go back to.
You'll like miss four times in a row and then like the enemy level 3 Pidgey will like crit you twice.
On a level, the remake, Fire Red and Leaf Green is so good.
Yeah, they're good. Yeah, they're brilliant games, but like, oh god, first gen. Oof. The re-release of the first gen is just making me want to play the fucking Fire Red and Leaf Green.
Yeah. I've been playing Fire Red on an emulator at like 1,000 speed. Like 1,000% speed. Yeah. I've just been doing like a Nuzlocke run just fucking about. And like, oh my god. Whenever I have to, for whatever reason, just go back to a normal speed, it's like painful. Like, why are Pokemon so slow? I mean, Gen 3, along with 5, are probably like the two fastest gens. But yeah. I'm still just like, oh, why is it so slow?
Yeah, like for the first like two, like half of the game, it's just so slow. Yeah. And then you get that bike that's only useful in some places.
Yeah.
Well, in reality, you need the fucking acro bike because like half the shit is for the acro bike.
Yeah. No, that's just in like Emerald and that. In Fire Red.
I've been playing those. I got back to work on the Berserk video. I finished chapter 2 of 6 now.
Okay.
For those of you who don't know, the Berserk chapters are ridiculously long and actually pretty hard. Pretty unforgiving, actually, and there's a lot of like grinding because it was never a title released in the West, and you know. You know how those weebs love that grind? No.
Oh god, weebs. Don't get me started.
So I've been playing. A lot of like Berserk to try and get the video up. Fash was hanging out with me as I was doing it and he was hearing me bitch, but I'm still having fun with it.
Okay. Anything still having else?
A good time. I played TMNT for like 30 minutes.
Oh, Sam. Sam.
No. I acquired it. I acquired it by other means, and I didn't buy it, so we're good.
You basically just wasted 30 minutes of your day. You realize that, right?
Well, like, because, like, Bash was like, no, Sam, you have to play this. I'll like...
No, I never... Hold on. Retract that statement immediately. I never, ever pushed you.
Well, no. Like, you were like, you should play it so I can get your opinion on it. I'm like, okay. So,
did,
like,
I say that? I don't think I said that.
Yeah,
you did. I guess I said that. Okay.
So I was like, okay, well, I'll. I don't want to wait till Vash season passes me, so I acquired it. And I did the tutorial. I'm like, I don't see what he's bitching about. Oh. And then I got into the hub world.
And then you played.
I was like, oh, sweet Jesus, what is going on?
And then he played the video game.
Yeah, I played beyond the tutorial. And I'm like, oh, I have to stop this van. Oh, I'm hitting heli.
It's so bad. It's such a bad
not
game.
Great.
It's not a good game.
Not great. It's not great, Bash, but I feel like one day we should do a playthrough.
It's not going to be good. It's not gonna be-
Well, yeah, but you can listen to me solemnly, like, die inside every time a bad TMNT joke is made.
They barely talk.
Oh, even better.
Well, they barely talk about anything other than just, like, fucking generic dialogue lines.
Which... Yeah, don't they repeat one-liners, like,
Ed Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I got one that was super solid. So,
oh, yeah?
Are you done with your week, Sam?
Yeah, I'm done with my week.
So, this week I played a couple of things, not really. I haven't touched much Overwatch. I've played more, actually got back into some Call of Duty Black Ops Zombies. Which I'll be elaborating on maybe in a future video. I've actually been having a lot of fun with it, but now's not really the time for that. What I did do, though, was record a full hard playthrough of TMNT. And I got some good shit. I got some really good shit. Sam, did you ever get a mission where you had to stealth?
Yes, my first mission was a stealth mission.
I got one where it was on, like, a skyscraper mission. You have to fly over to the area before you can trigger the actual mission.
I mean, that sounds cool.
So, you fly over. April O'Neil is like, guys, you gotta be super sneak in this area. And then as soon as I regain control, the helicopter sees me, because the helicopter spawned with line of sight exactly where I landed. But what was great was that, like, April was still giving dialogue lines, and they were stacking.
It did a sonic boom on you.
For, like, 25 seconds at least, April was just talking, catching up to reality. The mission was over quicker than it began.
That's not like far off what happened in the show. It's just April talking over, like, actual things.
It was great. And then I got one where I caught some footage of enemies deliberately ignoring me as I was trying to defuse a bomb. Like, just everything was walking straight past me, trying to get to the other.
Vash, you resorted to my playstyle when playing that game of just trying to break it.
I didn't even try to break it. I went to the bomb and was holding circle, and everything ignored me. Enemies were spawning right next to me, and then they were just...
A new breed of stealth.
Tactical espionage action. Like
total espionage action.
Little chicken bots would spawn right next to me. And then they would run off to fight the other three turtles. Oh, it was great. I need to go back and review all the footage. I want to make a high... Oh, no! I got one where I actually saw a helicopter despawn directly in front of me.
Hey, Vash. For me singing, like, the sad version of the song, do you want, like, that over all your bad footage?
Do it.
Oh, I should do, like, a special video.
Yeah.
Where it's just the highlight reel of everything that got fucked up. It'd be great.
Yeah, just have me singing, like, somberly over it.
It'd be great. But yeah,
Turtle power!
I did a thing that I saw because in Skype, Charlie and John were talking about how difficult Transformers Devastation was.
And, really not.
Well, I had a thought, which is like, yeah, maybe they're right. Maybe the game is a little difficult. So I started a new game, completely new game, removed my save file. Didn't delete it, just moved it. Went on hard. And the only thing that gave me a slip up was the Devastator fight because of how long it takes. But even that wasn't that bad.
I struggled a bit on the Devastator fight, but not
the
a whole
Devastator
lot.
Fight just takes forever.
The Constructicons one,
the Constructicons
on the other hand,
just
kicks my balls.
Actually, I beat all of them in my first try.
Oh, shut up.
You can't even... No,
I don't have anything to say, just shut up!
Here's the thing, like, it's not even like... It's because I've played it for so long. Because what I actually like about Transformers Devastation is that I'm playing on Prime difficulty, which is the highest possible difficulty. Enemies actually move faster, and their animations are faster. So when you bump yourself down to Commander difficulty, which is the highest available at the start, enemies are so slow. They are so just like in everything.
Like within the you can get hit within like the first few seconds of that Constructicons fight.
That's incredibly slow.
One time I pressed like retry and I just wasn't looking for a sec because I went to get my phone and then I'd already taken a hit and I was just like, well, there's no point in me even trying for the rest of the fight because I'm not going to survive. Because like one hit takes off like more than a third of your health. And I was saying to Vash before the show started, like, it can be really annoying, but what can happen, especially if you're facing multiple enemies like this boss fight, is if you get stunned, even if it's not an official, like, stun attack, you know, if you get caught in one attack animation, you know, another enemy hitting you, then you can potentially get caught in, like, two or three more moves. So it's like, you get hit once, you know, you mess up once, and you essentially get punished for it three times over, and then all your health just goes in one go.
It's because you're fat and gay.
Yeah.
Well, yeah.
All I can say, really. No, I never upgraded any of my damage. What I did do is I bought a couple of moves, because you can buy moves from the lab. Bought those, and I cleared every Constructicon double fight immediately. Kicked Megatron's ass immediately.
Actually, wait. In all fairness, this is coming from the guy who on his first run of Bayonetta 2, how many times was it that I died to the final fucking, I forgot the name, Angel Dudes, what are they called? Lumen Sage. The final Lumen Sage fight, I think I died 84 times?
Well, Lumen Sage is pretty difficult. He can be.
He is, but I'm finding this much more difficult.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh. I don't know what to tell
you. Lumen Sage, you don't die in like three hits.
on Infinite Climax.
Oh, on Infinite Climax, but that's not the hardest default difficulty. Whereas this is.
Yeah, I guess, maybe. You never know. Maybe some people just need a bit of a skill up. You're not alone, Charlie. Charlie was also... No, Charlie, your big boss was also...
Whoa.
Big boss was also like, fucking... Well, you see, TMNT, or Transformers on Hard, is the most difficult game ever. And it's not.
Is it bad that, like, I didn't struggle on Transformers on Hard?
No.
I'm finding it pretty hard.
It's because people are good at video games.
I haven't played in a while, but...
I say this, and then people are going to ask me to stream playing on hard, and then I'm going to eat shit, and everyone's going to be like, oh, that's sad.
I might go back and do some more non-upgraded fights against prime difficulty bosses.
Please do.
That'd be fun.
Can I just say that I've been thinking about Revolver Ocelot, Troy Baker Revolver Ocelot, a lot lately. And
lately?
Did you ever see the film Inglourious Bastards?
Yes.
Inglourious Bastards.
Do you remember when Brad Pitt, towards the end, he's like, Arrivederci, you know, where he just says it completely wrong?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I would think that Baker could do it even better and just be like, Arrivederci.
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 All right, guys, one sec. I got to go fight evil for a couple minutes.
quite evil.
Is that what he calls getting his shit kicked in Transformers Devastation?
Hold up! I hadn't left yet!
Baited.
Outsmarted. But yeah, so that's what I've been up to. Just a lot of fucking zombies, actually, which took me by surprise. I have not played much Overwatch.
I've been watching him play.
You liked it though. You can't complain. You knew that Bo was hype.
It's hard to make a mode like that bad.
Killing Floor 2 kind of did it.
Oh gosh.
We'll talk about that later though.
I knew you were going there, and I'm letting you go.
But yeah, that's really what I've been up to. I think that's what we've all been up to. So let's get right into the news. So something that I think happened actually last week that we didn't cover, because I think it got to me too late. But No Man's Sky has been delayed into August 9th, or is it August 9th or 19th? Yes, it is 9th. They got bodied. And apparently, this has been so severe, so many people are so vexed, asshurt, as the term goes, that apparently No Man's Sky Man has received death threat diddlies for delaying his Project Arena.
And then, of course, there were people in the niche gamer audience who were being death threat apologists. Good going, guys.
Apologists.
But yeah, so this isn't really that big of a thing to me, at least, but I would like to get other people's opinions, not just on the death threat thing, but just on the delay in general, because, let's fucking let them talk, because I don't want to taint the water. So what are we thinking about this?
Well, my hype for that game died down, last year, I think.
Did it really?
Yeah. I was originally pretty excited about it, just because of just the notion, infinite galaxies, everything so different, procedurally generated, oh my dick. And every time they show new bits of gameplay, I'm just seeing really nothing that too interested in being involved with.
Right.
You know, I mean, I've already made statements about the general pastel color palette, like, that doesn't really appeal to me art-wise, but I can look past that if the game's just going to be, just a lot of fun. Hopefully it is, but honestly, after watching more gameplay of what's that other Starship game where you can fucking fly around all the time?
Elite Dangerous. They're gonna say Star Citizen.
Like when I was watching more gameplay of Elite Dangerous, that's the kind of game that I think that I would just rather play.
Okay.
Like, it looks like there's more player agency, more player interaction, more just it looks like it's. It looks like it does what No Man's Sky promises to do better. And also has a more comfy atmosphere. Yeah. Elite Dangerous do what No Man's Sky not released yet, so...
You don't think those space sims be like they is, but they do.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't care, but at the same time, hey, I hope the delay makes the game better.
Yeah.
It doesn't always happen. I mean, look at Star Fox Zero, but, sometimes it does.
Right. So, anybody else want to chip in on this?
No. Actually, no.
No. I'm pretty much in the same boat as Pokey. Like, I was really excited for it, but it's just the longer it takes to come out, the less I'm going to be into it. It might be something I'm gonna really enjoy once it comes out, but I'm not actively thinking about it.
I'll probably get it when it's a little cheaper. I mean, because I have like Elite Dangerous, and it's fucking great, best. But me and Vasha played it, love it, it's a good time.
Yep,
takes forever to do anything, but I mean that's what the point of the fucking
game.
That's
the point of the game, yeah.
So yeah. Right now, honestly, I didn't even know that the game had a release date planned. Like, I've not really been following, but honestly, like, the August 9th thing is the first I've heard of it. I've heard of previous delays, but I've not really heard of, like, them coming back with a set date of when it will launch. August 9th isn't really that far away for me, honestly. I'm hoping to get the game. I'm still interested in it. I've not died out on... Actually, yeah, that's a lie. I've died out a lot on interest just because I've seen so much of it and played nothing. But, yeah, I'm actually pretty okay with them just coming out just from a stance of ignorance because I've not heard anything about a date yet. And honestly, assuming sure they... Oh, go ahead.
Sure, Vash, and I will pick it up.
Yeah, and assuming that they actually, you know, polish it, take the time, because I'm assuming that's what this time is for. This delay is just to make the game work better. I am perfectly okay with that. So, yeah, that's just sort of the first topic. I'm not really sure if this should have been on last week or not, but I wanted to clear the air on that because it is important. And then straight into the next one. Fucking
stop it.
Ibuki. Oh, no. So let's
Ibuki,
talk.
Ibuki on the dick.
Oh, so Street Fighter.
We got Dax's topic.
Street Fighter V has got a new character announced. Their third DLC character.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Alex Guile Ibuki.
Yeah, Alex Guile Ibuki. She got her trailer. Is she out yet, or is she?
No, she was actually delayed until she was going to be at the end of May. And then, because what they're going to do is that they're going to have the character release, you know, this month, like in the last couple months, and they're going to lead into June being the story mode, cinematic story update, and all that stuff. It's actually been delayed till June, and a lot of that is going along with Capcom's whole thing that we talked about a couple weeks back, which was the quality control thing. Where they're just like, yeah, we'll delay what the fuck ever if we want the quality to be better. We'll see how that goes. But that does tie into a bunch of that as well as a bunch of other fixes and that kind of stuff. She has been delayed till June, but the rest of the update stuff is still scheduled to be on time. So it's just going to be one big update instead.
So personally, I never really played Ibuki. Honestly, not really much of the Street Fighter V cast currently appeals to me. I was hoping really that we would have gotten some type of like hint that Dudley would have been coming at some point, even though that's not projected for this year at all.
Mm-hmm.
But Ibuki looks all right from a gameplay perspective. I just fucking hate her outfit.
I'm not a fan. It's sort of a blend of one of her DLC outfits before, which was the schoolgirl alt, as well as like these kind of armor pieces and other such.
And isn't this supposed to be like in the future?
It's after 4, but before 3.
Oh, okay. All right, so, I guess that makes sense.
I really don't like her hair.
I never cared for her design that much in general. I honestly prefer the more simplistic outfit. And I mean, she goes back to it in 3, the simple brown outfit. But that'll probably be an alt or some shit.
Hoping against hope that when she actually comes out, I mean, she'll be nice when I finally do get Street Fighter V. I still need to grab it. But yeah, for now, it's good that she's there. I think it's nice that Capcom are actually at least showing stuff at a reasonable time frame instead of just releasing it. Hopefully we get to see...
It's been steady.
Yeah, hopefully we get to see some actual gameplay from some sort of Capcom rep.
Well, they have. I mean, what's nice, what they've been doing for the last couple months too, is that they did this with Alex and Guile. Like, the day after the announcement, they'll Capcom UK does a stream where they basically have a bunch of pro players on and they just play with that character. And they play for like hours and hours and hours, and so you get to see all sorts of stuff. And these top players, of course, I mean, they can figure out a lot of fundamental things pretty quickly, and so you start to see some really early conceptual stuff of what the character is capable of, and it's really interesting. I like this rendition, and what's interesting about characters like this who especially characters who are carrying a lot of elements and stuff over from something like SF4, where it was a very vortex heavy kind of game. You know, if you had if your game, at least before Ultra, was built around getting some sort of hard knockdown off most of your options and then going for some sort of vortex setup that's very difficult to deal with, that was your game, and those characters were at the top. And of course, they introduced things like delayed wake up, which sort of affected that, but it was more along the lines of, okay, if I get this knocked out, if I guess which wake up they're going to do, I have a setup for it. And there's a lot of stuff like that. And that stuff is in 5, but you have much more. You have normal wake up, you have delayed wake up, you have a back roll. There's a lot more options to deal with, as well as stuff like V reversal. You're basically your alpha counter to get people off of you. So I like the idea of having a character like this having to work around those tools. And you can tell, like, obviously she's much more lenient in terms of projectiles. Instead of having just a air kunai that goes downward at a specific angle, now she has a multi-projectile. She can throw multiples at once, also from either at the ground, straight forward from in the air. She does actually have a meter. She has a kunai meter. I don't know how exactly she refills it, or if she can like cancel certain moves into a knockdown and then maybe refill on that, sort of like if you ever watched Hakan in 4, he would often do a slide, and he could either do a slide into the belly flop, which would have more damage, or you could do slide and cancel into oil. So you get the knockdown, and then you also get to build up your oil. So there could be stuff like that. I'm not sure if there's a command for it or if she builds it back up over time.
Right.
But I think that's interesting. And of course, her B trigger being this bomb that allows for combo utility as well. And it also has a lot of smoke and particle effects and whatever else. So there could be some sort of situation where you could throw the bomb during a block string or a setup and then obscure the opponent or yourself to make it to where it's difficult to see. She even has the glide in the air. She has a little hover that she can do, so she can delay. So if you're going to go, you know, if you jump in, if the opponent's going to go for an anti-air, you can delay it a little bit and then come down on them, get a counter hit, that sort of stuff. So they made her approach options definitely scarier, which is really interesting. And she still seems to be pretty fast, pretty quick overall. A lot of her buttons look mostly the same from 4, not a lot of different properties. This is going to be some general differences with like juggle properties. I think it's her forward roundhouse I saw could juggle into her hit grab, where she like grabs you and does the little fucking, what's the Naruto, the Rasengan thing at you. She still has all of her looks like she still has all of her general target combos, her the one that ends in like the hard kick launcher and that sort of stuff is still in there. So a lot of the fundamental stuff still seems pretty much the same. And
seems to be probably one of their more tame renditions of a character, to my eyes at least, because Guile and Alex don't look like I remember seeing them in 4 or 3.
But no, Alex is fucking hideous.
No, I'm talking about gameplay.
In terms of how they work. Well, I think Alex for the most part is fairly similar. He just, again, like, it's kind of how they work within the engine. Like this, five is very much a sort of 4 meets 3 blend, and I feel like Ibuki's kind of character works really well on that, regardless of the situation. You tweak a couple things that are fitting for this, for the kind of engine and for the kind of knockdown game that the meta works around, and then, you know, she can pretty much fit in whatever. Whereas like with how aggressive many of the characters are in this game, obviously they kind of retooled Guile to where he can do a lot of that kind of stuff, and then took away some defensive options, obviously, like his, you know, flash kick is not invincible unless it's EX, like that sort of thing. It made it like more meter intensive, and that's a common way to deal with that sort of problem. But I don't know. I mean, she looks interesting. So we'll see how that goes. And of course, you know, when she comes out, we'll also have the cinematic story mode thing, which we'll we'll see how that goes. I don't know. It might be fun to watch. It's gonna be dumb, but that's fine.
Yeah. Okay.
I mean, it's what you expect. Like Street Fighter lore isn't exactly the most tight thing, unless you're reading the comics, I guess.
Don't worry about it.
It's cool. It's a fucking fighting game. Who gives a shit? It's not Blazeball. It's not gonna take a year to figure out.
I mean, next topic's pretty tight.
Yeah. So let's go ahead and hop forward a little bit. So the Xbox One has dropped to $300. It's technically $299, but it's fucking $300 and probably a little bit more after tax, in terms of pricing as the base. And I think it's like 249 euro or
somewhere along those. Maybe I think 279.
Yeah, no, I hope not. That's probably a lot more, but the Xbox One has finally hit a fucking decent price drop, and I think it's good to see. But I don't really, actually, fuck it, you guys go first. What are you thinking about this, Sam? You seem interested. What's going on?
Well, it's an interesting response, especially with, like, you know, like, poor sales and things like that. I imagine they're not selling as well now.
Yeah, because Halo 5... What exclusives? I was having a talk with this with Terry yesterday, and we were having a lot of trouble coming up with actually fun exclusives for the platform. Definitely Sunset Overdrive, but I can't think of much else outside of
Sunset Overdrive at 30 FPS.
Yeah. Well, nothing's perfect. Especially not when you're a current
like console. Aside from like the 30 frames per second, like Sunset Overdrive is so fucking solid.
Yeah.
So, I'm sure it's a great game. It just saddens me.
Yeah. that's fair.
I don't want the only great skating game that plays at 60 FPS to be aggressive inline only.
If you want a good skating game, you could play Overwatch.
Oh! Or you could play Tony Hawk.
Pro Skater 5. I love me the Tony Hawk. I'm talking about, like, you know, actual skates on the feet. I'm not talking about.
Yeah, just any skate. I know. I'm shit posting.
The way I see this is, it's a $350 scale bound machine. It makes the bullet a little bit better to bite, and that's only if scale bound doesn't come to PC. Yeah. So.
Which is highly likely eventually.
Let me also say this as well. Good on Microsoft for making the initiative to try to push forth more backwards compatibility support for the console. And I mean, we do know that they want to look forward and look for a way to get original Xbox games on the Xbox One.
Yeah.
Now, granted, there aren't many good Xbox original games. You know, not everything is a Panzer Dragoon Orta or a Jet Set Radio Future, but it does have its few good solid titles. Especially if Metal Wolf Chaos never does get brought over to America, then you could just import it and then slap it onto the X-Bone. So I guess that's how I could also see it as. It's a $300 potentially super backwards compatible Xbox legacy machine.
Maybe. So that's cool. But still.
Yeah, potentially. It's not set in stone, but potentially.
Well, John's not really here right now, but I know what Gaming Brit opinion he would espouse, and that is that this generation is kind of fucking bad.
It's pretty bad.
This generation is pretty terrible. Like, we're hitting a price drop, and I don't care. There's nothing worth playing on these platforms. Not enough to substantiate a purchase of, like, $350 fucking dollars.
Yeah, not wrong.
It's like, when the biggest claim to fame is that, hey, it runs shit that you could have gotten several years ago. It's not boding well. It's not doing good. Not doing good at all. And, like, sure, it's nice to see, but it's also like, what response does this have to say about what their plans are for the future? Like, maybe Microsoft are at a point to where they can't really, you know, they're just trying to push hardware sales as much as they can, but weren't there rumors that they were going to, they're doing that fucking initiative where they can have, like, a moddable console.
I'm not sure about by the way, it's only speculation.
Yeah.
That's not even confirmed. The Xbox successor is codenamed Scorpio, I think, or something along those lines. And I think the claim is that it's like 4 times more powerful than the original Xbox One. Not that that's difficult to do, but...
Yeah, especially now with current gen. Has any console manufacturer expressed any interest in using the new generation of GPUs?
FinFET, we've not heard anything regarding FinFET technology. I would super love it if they did. It would make sense because it's actually cheaper to produce those chips than it is to produce
the old ones, yeah.
The now obsolete chips. So if they don't embrace that, then that would just be completely fucking retarded of them. It would actively be a detriment to their wallets.
Certainly.
So, here's the hope, and here's the hope that we can actually see a generation of consoles come up that use modern technology, because for once, it's fucking price worth doing so.
And seeing them announce this prior to E3 is like, so this isn't going to be like some big main stage reveal. Yeah. They're like, yeah, we know we did this. Here's why maybe that's what's going on. Maybe this E3 will be like, okay, we made the console cheaper. Now here's why we're going to justify that still kind of expensive purchase. That would be nice. But for those of you who don't know, I made an executive decision. Next week's podcast will air at the same time, but it will be an E3 predictions and hopes podcast.
Okay.
So we'll be able to talk about all the good shit there. But yeah, just it would be nice if this was actually a precursor to something positive for Microsoft, because right now it doesn't seem like a good thing, or at least not an overtly positive one.
With so little information, yeah, it's difficult to make the judgment call.
Yeah, but yeah, it's gonna be good. Hopefully, never.
Yeah.
Never.
Never ever. Good things don't happen.
Never buying an Xbox One, not even for Scalebound. Hideki Kami is a hack. Same. His games are good in spite of him, honestly. That is me filling time as I look at what's next on the dock. Oh, this one. Do I want to talk
about
this?
That's all you.
Oh, this one's good.
No, stop that. You don't have to do this.
Killing floor two, my brethren. My brethren. I'll keep this one brief.
I would just like to remind you, Vash, that you made me buy Killing Floor 2 because you were like, oh, it's going to be so great, Sam.
Okay, in Vash's defense, the development blogs were showing a genuine passion project.
Oh yeah, certainly.
There he goes, jumping to defend Vash again.
Hey, I defend you too, Sam.
Yeah. Do you? Yeah, what now, Sam? Fight me.
Does he?
Anyway.
I do, frequently.
What's going on right now is that Killing Floor 2 is set to release officially on PlayStation 4 sometime this year, which is interesting because the game is still definitely an early access project. They are still adding, they are still balancing, they are still tweaking, they are still making new things for Killing Floor 2. The game is not even officially out yet while I'm looking for fucking gameplay. Right now, this is something that's just come down recently that they want to release this as a full title, which I don't know what this is the precursor to, because logically this would mean that, you know, Killing Floor 2 is actually going to become an official release at some point in the near future. But currently, it's not in any state to where it's even remotely comparable to Killing Floor 1 at launch, or just in terms of pure of like class variety or map variety, things like that. They are still very much so in the fucking process of trying to make this game. But regardless, they're trying to push it to retail stores like a shipped finished game at some point, and they have not gotten the game to a point to where I think it's even worth the early access purchase, which is weird because I was very excited for this game when it first came out. But after seeing how long it's taken them to implement some things like the not even the sharpshooter class, but like just adding stuff like, you know, demolitions and shit like that, they're still bringing new shit into it basically. And it's not good. It's not a good fucking early access title. It's not a good representation of faith from the developer, and they just keep pushing it without actually finishing it. So really, that's all I wanted to say about this one. Just I'm very, very ashamed of Tripwire, and I'm very mad at myself for making the purchase. So just as a bit of a prelude, if anybody sees this game on store shelves, it most likely will not be in any type of finished state, and it will also probably require a shit ton of patches as soon as you get it. And this is all assuming that the game ever gets finished at all, which is honestly not likely. So, yeah, that's just more of a PSA. If you want a good Horde mode experience, you could just go play Call of Duty Zombies.
Mass Effect 3.
No, not that thing.
Everyone, Mass Effect 3 came out, everyone was always like, God, that game shit. Multiplayer's pretty good, though. It's pretty good Horde mode.
Well, the thing is, right, when I made that video when Killing Floor 2 first came out, I was under the distinct impression that they weren't going to be turtles about, like, supporting it. But they've taken a long time, a lot longer than I thought they would, which... When did this game first come out? Was it 2015? It's been a long time, to put it lightly. It's been an extremely long time since we've actually had the game first hit early access. So, not happy about that, quite frankly. I think the fact that they're already talking about pushing it out to retail before they've even gotten the game out of early access on PC is a bit of a piss take. I don't know. Not happy about it either way. But moving on to potentially happier news, especially with eyes going forward to E3. Crash.
My card about to blow up with being super right, too.
Cash Bandicoot has been listed on a German... A new Crash Bandicoot title has been listed on a German distributor. I don't recall what the name of it is. I would need to look that up. But basically, what's going on is a new Crash Bandicoot title has been hinted at being in the works, and we might be seeing something at E3. So... let's get some jolly speculation going on right here.
It's
gonna be platinum. It's gonna be a platinum game.
I hope
it's gonna be Crash Platinum, and it's gonna be what do they label it as? Jump and run? Because yes, they can't just say platformer.
They label it
like you can't say beat 'em up anymore. You have to say hack and slash or character action. Mm-hmm. So now instead of saying platformer, it's now jump and run.
Yeah.
That's so gay. Anyway, it's totally going to be a platinum game, and my E3 bingo card's going to blow the fuck up with being just so correct. And
I still need to make my E3 bingo card.
Yeah, I haven't made mine either.
I need to hurry up and get it.
I'm expecting. You know what I'm expecting. I'm expecting. Remember those GBA games? That one was Crash and Spiral World, and one was Spiral.
Yes,
and Spiral World.
I played.
It's going to be a. It's going to be a PS4 remake. Of that one, except it's Crash in Skylanders World.
Yeah, that would be pretty awful.
So right now, it's a little unclear who would be managing this project, who would be the developer of this project, what its exclusivity state would be. But either way, it could be a Ratchet and Clank deal, where they just remake the first game and be like, oh, we were.
Or even better, they remake the second game because that was the best one.
Yeah.
That is true.
You never know. But either way, this is just a new listing for a game that I played as a kid. And I just hope that it doesn't get fucked Italy'd. Because that would be sad. But also, at the same time, I don't know. For whatever reason, I don't think we're going to get a return to the old Crash Bandicoot titles of the past. Just because I think that it's sort of antiquated at this point. It's just sort of like an older type of game. Especially if we're talking like a PS1 style remake.
The only way we're going to see a Ratchet & Clank game like that, being completely serious, is if they make some sort of like app game for it, because they would take that simplicity. You know they would. They would make some sort of thing, and it would basically be like a pseudo Temple Run kind of thing, and they would just stick that kind of. That's the only way they're going to make something that
simple,
straightforward.
Yeah,
is yeah. They would make something like that. They're not going to like put that out.
Well, they could put an upgrade system. Like,
well,
in
today's
there,
gamers don't want to say that.
Launch nukes from your fucking feet.
But now there's it's so weird to hear all this shit about fucking just old ass fucking franchises being revived like Ratchet and Crash when the PS4 has like hardly anything new. console generation is dead, folks. I don't know what to tell you.
Hey, Legend of Dragoon is still an IP that Sony owns, just saying that they never want to do anything with it.
No, of course not. It's terrible. But yeah, this is hopefully this will probably be expanded upon more during the E3 prediction cast. But my hopes are that this actually does go somewhere and it becomes something, because while it might not be like the Crash Bandicoots that I remember playing as a kid, it could be something that gets like maybe a younger generation into it, or just completely drives it further into the ground, which would be sad. But right. So there's that topic down. And this is something that John put on here, which...
Well, we'll skip Drive? It because he's not here.
No, not Drive.
Damn it.
But this does sort of deal a little bit, just a little bit, with something that I care about at least, and that is Ubisoft. Currently, there's been a bit of a bureaucratic issue going on over in France, in French land. Ubisoft, at least, is potentially looking to get bought out by a French multimedia corporation, Vivendi. So let me put this up there now. What's going on is Vivendi has acquired Gameloft. And this is pointing in the direction that potentially a CEO could resign. And that Vivendi is looking to amass a certain amount of funds in order to make an offer for Ubisoft, as in they will own Ubisoft. Now, this is something that a lot of people probably don't care that much about, and I can understand why, but I sort of care about this in a sense, because Ubisoft doesn't hold many IPs that I care about, but they do hold one that I do actually love, and that is Rayman. Even though they have not made an actual Rayman game since Rayman Legends, which is perfectly fine because that game is fucking great, they haven't really touched that IP in the longest, and I would like to hopefully see it just brought back and taken a bit more seriously from the UbiArt crew. But more so than that, this could potentially be one of the largest buyouts of a company in, like, gaming history. So, I don't know if anybody here is all that familiar with this case, but I want to know what you guys at least think of a potential Ubisoft changing of hands.
Well, Vivendi's odd, because if I recall, they used to also own Activision Blizzard, didn't they?
If memory serves, they did at least hold shares in them at one point.
Yeah. I have never heard of Vivendi themselves being too invasive as a company.
Right.
Obviously, Vivendi is, much like many other larger organizations, sort of just uses all this share pool in order to advertise certain things.
Yeah.
So, I honestly can't really think of how much or really what is genuinely going to change, because with Activision Blizzard we haven't really seen much of a change. That's if I recall, if I'm thinking of this the right way. Might be completely wrong. I'm in fact, for all I fucking know, they could have bought them out recently, but I don't know. It's not really coming to mind.
What's interesting about the Vivendi case is that apparently Ubisoft wants to retain their degree of independence, even though they are technically a publicly traded company.
Yeah.
That was what stood out to me the most, is that Vivendi already has over 15% share in Ubisoft, to the point to where I think Vivendi has some type of representation on the board level for Ubisoft. But even then, they're still saying that they wish to retain a degree of independence and be their own company, even though, like I said, they're publicly traded. So, yeah. I don't know how much a Vivendi buyout would even change Ubisoft, because as far as I know, they, and as far as what we care about, they're not going to stop making Assassin's Creed games. They're not going to stop making fucking titles that nobody cares about anyway. But, more so than that, they don't really seem to be showing any interest in making another Rayman title with the UbiArt engine. Which, I mean, sort of makes sense, because if anybody's ever played through Rayman Legends and has seen the end credits, a lot of fucking people worked on that game for a long-ass time.
Mm-hmm.
Like, and it shows, like, the love and effort does show, but fuck, that was a huge commitment. So, I don't know. I don't know if Vivendi would look at that and be like, okay, we're actually going to use our, we're going to use our IP in a certain way, or we're not going to do so. It's all up in the air right now. We're not even sure if a buyout's going to exist, but what we do know is that Ubisoft, on some level, is a little bit worried about a buyout, or they're worried about actions taken, and they have made it expressly clear that they don't want to be bought up by Vivendi. At least that's what they're telling reporters. So. Yeah, you never know. Not really too worried about this one, honestly. It's just, I mean, when you think about it, Ubisoft has pissed off so many people in the 7th and 8th gens, and they've...
Especially with all that Aisha Taylor.
Oh, we'll save it for next week.
Are you a meme?
make your meme right now. Just stares awkwardly.
I can picture Picard.
And a meme. But right. So that pretty much wraps it up for the actual news segments. Now, Pokey, I do want to ask you something before we hit our final topic. Have you seen the Warcraft movie?
Nah, I haven't seen because it yet.
It dawned on me in the wee hours of the night that we need to do the Bonfire Lit Warcast.
Yeah.
Because the movie's out, and Legion's actually a little bit further behind, but the movie's out, so we should probably cover that at some point. Are you ready?
I mean, maybe.
Are you ready for the series? Because it's going to be a series of Warcasts, really.
Yeah, yeah.
Which reminds me, I need to ask you for some production help with that, because I do want to. Right. I don't want to have fucking Dark Souls over a fucking fucking Warcraft discussion.
A Warcraft, yeah, yeah.
we'll figure something out, but can't wait. Cannot wait for that. But anyway, let's get to the final topic of the show. Something that we like to do every week. And that is what we're playing. Or what we're working on right now.
You fucked up!
I don't even care, Sam. I'm living life. I'm living the dream. The meme dream. Shadow. I have my cat here. So, I'm winning. So talk to me, boys. Whoever wants to go first. What are we working on?
I'm working on my sex thing.
Oh.
Mm.
There's sex in the future.
I like sex.
Good thing. Proud of you. Proud of you.
My audience is about to lose their virginity.
Whoa.
Forcefully.
Whoa.
You will be devoured.
So is that a Final Fantasy script?
Yes.
Good. But no, seriously, are you working on anything right now?
Well, those are the two things I'm working on.
You're working on deflowering the audience through Final Fantasy?
That, and also the script regarding critiquing sexual content.
Sam being loud has nothing to do with my audio. It's just because he shouted for no reason.
Yeah, Sam just is loud.
Yeah,
it's his default.
You have to assume that I'm loud because I'm Irish and I've had two tequila beers, so...
Yeah, he does what he does. He drinks. He has a problem.
Well, this is the first time I've drunk in months.
That's at least what I'll say. Because we have evidence to catch him out on it.
I do not have a problem. It is the world that has the problem.
It's true.
No, it is them who is wrong.
Right. So you're working on that right now?
Yes, yeah, so those are the two things I'm working on. I'm still working on my critiquing sexual content, which I really don't want to rail on that again because I pretty much already gave away too much information last time. So
yeah.
Still want there to be some surprise. And yeah, working on the Final Fantasy. Well, I'm not even like really working on that. Like, it's done pretty much. Well, script wise, it's done.
Mm-hmm.
I still need to record it, obviously, and make the video. But I need Clems to contribute his vocal portions as well. Which, like I said last time, I'm not putting a deadline on him or anything, so he can get to me with that whenever he wants. But the thing I'm largely focusing on is the critiquing sex. Okay. In video games.
Okay. Cool. Daxy Dong Diddly. Talk to me about what you're working on. It could be anything.
Yeah, mostly a lot of the same stuff as before. Again, I've still been just behind with as much speedrunning shit, both between the marathons going on currently that I talked about previously, as well as SGDQ prep, since I'll be gone for about 8 or 9 days for that at the beginning of July. But so I've been just kind of like doing a bunch of prep work for different videos. I should have at least two out before the end of the month. One being, of course, the Black Knight video, which is mostly done, and as well as a couple others that are mostly in script for. I just need to record for. But I have been just thinking about a lot of different stuff that I want to do, because there's definitely a lot more videos about various animated films or series that I've thought about in the past that I really do want to do.
Okay.
And I mean, get to the point, based on how many ideas I have and what I actually pursue doing, like, my channel is going to have like a lot more of those than I definitely thought. Which is totally fine, because I like that kind of shit.
What you should do is you should pitch Vash about your animated movie, and you should say that it's going to be in 4K, but you're all going to send it over Skype.
No, oh, I've not fucking had that meme in a long time. Nobody even knows. I've never told this story.
Yeah.
Maybe.
What did I miss, boys?
I'm not telling the story. The story is too lengthy. It's just too much bad.
Anyway, what did I miss?
We're in the last topic of the show.
Ah, cool.
So, Who hasn't gone yet? Sam, what are you working on?
I got back to work on my Berserk video.
Good.
I'm on chapter 3, so I only have 3 more parts to do, and then the bonus section.
Uh-huh.
So that's gonna be super fun. I'm gonna need help from maybe a little bit from everybody in the crew, which is fine. I'm hoping to make it a collaborative thing. That's why I'm putting it on Bonfire Lit.
Okay.
I've been working on that, and then I've got some other ideas for some other stuff that I maybe might pursue. I don't know. I don't make videos. I just tell you that your videos are bad.
Yep. Damn. It's true.
But that's all for me.
So,
Other than like doing the giveaway at the end of the stream, which I'm gonna set up now.
Are you gonna be streaming after the stream?
I'm not, but I'm just because I said I would. I'm gonna be giving away a random game on this stream. I'm gonna use a number generator to win the game. You have to be followed to this channel as well as my channel on Twitch. I think that's fair.
Okay.
Yeah, that's me.
John.
What am I working on? Well, since the Fear video, I haven't done a whole lot of progress because, I mean, fuck, I've got these exams, I've got 5 next week, it's kind of dead. But I have got 3 ideas for videos, 2 of which I've briefly mentioned here before. One is the Credo boss design video, another is the Tropical Freeze video, and another is a sort of a bigger project, one that's sort of more near and dear to my heart, that I'm very excited to do. And I'm not sure if I should actually do that first. The Credo one, I mean, I haven't exactly worked on it for a while, but that's part of the reason for what I'm about to say. Because I've got these other ideas and stuff, I've started thinking, like, do I even really care that much about the Credo thing? It might be interesting or whatever, but I'm not feeling a huge amount of motivation to do it. This other project is a lot more enticing to me, but the only thing is about... What?
Nothing.
Oh, nothing. I know what you...
Nothing.
What was I talking about? Oh, yeah, okay, the thing is, after my exams end in about... In two weeks. I'm sort of busy partying and sucking dick and whatever for a couple of weeks, and I've but then after like 3 or so weeks I go on holiday for like 8 weeks, and so I wouldn't get any video progress done. So I'm not sure whether to get 1 if not 2 of these short videos done then, and then script the rest of this video, and then script the sort of bigger video over summer where I won't have my PC, or whether I should just go ham and crank out this sort of bigger video, because I'm still not entirely sure how to structure it, and I sort of know vaguely the points I can make, but not exactly what the point of it is, if that makes sense. I'm just kind of saying, oh, this is a thing, this is a similar thing. I need to get an actual kind of defining thread running through it.
Okay.
I won't really say what it is, but you guys who know me and know my stuff can probably guess vaguely what it might be on. It's on 2 games, I'll give you that. But other than that, I've got nothing in the works. But fuck, that's 3 videos, man. Credo, Tropical Freeze, and this other dickhead fuckery. That's all I've got.
Is that everybody?
Yeah.
Alright, so I've just been, like I said, I recorded the TMNT gameplay for the TMNT video. I still need to get the cutscenes, but that won't take long. That really won't take long. Then I need to probably capture some extra gameplay from other Platinum games and shit like that, just to have it for extra B-roll. Script is done, script is written, script is... I think it's pretty good. It's way different than the other investigation I did, which is nice. But I don't know how long the editing process will take. I'm hoping for a lengthier editing process to just make it look better and flow better. Outside of that, what else am I working on? I've not outlined anything at all. There's literally nothing down. Actually, I'm not even going to talk about it because it's not going to be something that I'm going to be able to do with any amount of justice until like the Steam sale comes, because it's going to be probably a stupid purchase.
Team Fortress 2 hat bundle.
No, I've not even started working on the Team Fortress 2 video. God. than the yeah, but it's just going to be a big purchase because there's a lot of things I need to buy in order to get enough footage for it. I already have the games. I just need to get the DLC for it. I think that's it. That's all I got. So yeah, the TMNT video is going along nicely. I've not recorded the script yet, but I will soon. And then, like I said, just as far as stuff goes for this channel, Bonfire Lit, expect next week to be the E3 predictions and hope cast for stuff like that. We're going to try and get as many people in as possible. We will not cover... we're not going to cover weeks. We're not going to do anything like that. We're just going to fucking jump straight into it because there's a lot of conferences going on. There's a lot of shit to call. And then in the near future, also expect to see a new timing for the Bonfire Lit Warcast, which is going to deal with World of Warcraft and the Warcraft movie and Legion, because that's a topic that is important to myself, it's important to Pokey, it's important to Luke, and we will definitely try to get Ian on for that as well. He is somebody who is not really featured on many casts. I think he's only been on the one, the other Warcast, and then we can do that. So expect that in the near future. I'm not sure if anybody else would really be able to contribute anything. I mean, I know John doesn't play games.
Hold up, I've been playing like 4 games this last week. Yeah, I've been playing 2 of the best games ever made, which you've never played.
Well, Sam knows where Keck came from.
Keck. So we can just be in the background constantly yelling Top Keck.
Top Keck.
Top Keck.
Why do you guys love that so much?
Because it's good.
You put all the right emphasis on all the right areas. You did a good job.
What is like dying inside as I say Top Keck?
Every orc's dying on the inside. Chris Metzen overwrites them.
Oof.
Have I played Duskforce yet? Yes. But yeah, okay. That's.
So I guess I should activate the random number generator to find out who's getting the game.
Go for it. So, this is the end of the Bonfire Lit Comfy Cast, guys. We'll leave the stream on after for the giveaway, but this is the end of the VOD. So, say goodbye, everybody.
Good to be here. That's what I was thinking. That's what I meant to say.
You're imprisoning me. All that I see. Absolute savings. Look at these jeans. What a great find. Put them on. Gotta look sexy as hell.
That is it from the Bonfire Lit Comfy Cast. This is episode 20, guys. Ooh. See you later.
Remember to follow me at twitch.tv/trihex.
Yes. Follow me on twitch.tv/caseytron.
And he's got the tits for it. I've seen his tits.
All right,
bye guys. Mussolini did nothing wrong.